Good morning to our audience in the United States. Good afternoon to our audience in Europe, and welcome wherever you are in the world watching this program. I'm Fred Kemp. I'm President and CEO of the Atlantic Council. It's my pleasure today to welcome you to a conversation with Bogdan Aurescu, the Minister of Foreign Affairs of Romania, on the security implications and security cooperation in the Black Sea. It is even more special to welcome the minister today in person in our Atlantic Council studios in Washington, D.C. It's also always a pleasure. We also have here in the studio the Romanian ambassador, the United States Ambassador Muraru. It's wonderful to have him here as well. Here at the Atlantic Council, it remains our core conviction that a strong transatlantic relationship is the backbone to a healthy international system. And for the last two decades, Romania has counted itself both as a committed member and proponent of the transatlantic relationship and as a key partner in the bilateral relationship with the United States. From post-Cold War transition to NATO membership and European integration, Romania has made truly impressive strides and has become an integral part of the NATO alliance. In fact, we're rapidly approaching the 20th anniversary of Romanian membership of NATO, which came in 2002, so the 20th anniversary will be next year, 2022. Since Romania's entry into NATO, and the invitation was 2002, but its entry came in 2004, Romania has been an active member in the alliance, contributing forces to NATO missions around the world, hosting a NATO military base and forces in Romania, and helping to shape the alliance's strategy, in particular in the Black Sea region. And that's what we're here to discuss today. The Black Sea region represents an area of immense geostrategic importance, not just for Romania and its neighbors, but also for the United States and NATO. The feeling is recognized at the highest levels of the US administration and at NATO headquarters. Secretary of Defense Lloyd Austin said as much while visiting Romania last month, stating that the region's security is, quote, in the U.S. national interest and critical for the security of NATO's eastern flank. We've also seen a growing commitment from NATO to the region and our NATO allies and partners, which border the Black Sea specifically, including the development of a tailored forward presence in the Black Sea region. The Council has a long-standing body of work on security in the Black Sea region, but I'm particularly proud to publicly announce for the first time that later this year we will formalize a partnership with Romania's National School of Political and Administrative Studies to help elevate the discussion on Black Sea security issues here in Washington. This is an important new partnership for the Atlantic Council and for U.S.-Romanian relations and for a focus on the Black Sea that will be ongoing and deeper. But the importance of the region goes beyond military and defense terms. In order to build a resilient and secure eastern flank, we cannot overlook the role of regional infrastructure, especially in the areas of energy and transportation, on which projects like the Central Europe launched and led 3Cs initiative focus. The Atlantic Council is proud to have worked with the Romanian government on the 3Cs summit in Bucharest in 2018. As Europe also navigates an energy crisis, and the first real energy price shock of the green era, and looks to the future of sustainable green energy, investing in independent energy resources will remain a priority for the region, the continent, and transatlantic alliance. I've just returned from Glasgow, and there was a very important announcement last week, where Special Presidential Envoy for Climate John Kerry and Romanian President Klaus Iohannis announced Romania's intent to build a first-of-its-kind U.S. small modular reactor to address the climate crisis. That just shows the different, very many different aspects of the bilateral relationship. So, Minister Aurescu, this is an important time for transatlantic cooperation in and around the Black Sea, and we look forward to hearing your thoughts. The minister is no stranger to these topics, having now served twice as Romania's Minister for Foreign Affairs, currently since 2019, previously from 2014 to 15, and also previously serving as the Romanian president's foreign policy advisor. He's a scholar of international law, holding roles as the Undersecretary of State for European Court of Justice, as a member of the Permanent Court of Arbitration at The Hague, as Romania's agent to the International Court of Justice, and as a member of the United Nations International Law Convention, just to name a few of his previous posts. So, Mr. Minister, it is a pleasure to have you with us at the Atlantic Council today. Before I turn over to Paula Dobriansky, the Vice Chair of the Scowcroft Center for Strategy and Security, to moderate this discussion, I encourage everyone to engage with this conversation by submitting your questions and using the hashtag #StrongerWithAllies on Twitter. So hashtag #StrongerWithAllies. And with that, Paula, over to you.
Right. Fred, thank you so much for that introduction. And Minister Aurescu, it's really a pleasure to have you here this morning. I'm not going to repeat Fred's appeal to our viewers, but I hope they are going to use the Zoom's audience Q&A feature because we want an active and vibrant discussion with you. And I'd like to start off with a broad question. You know, you're here in Washington, in fact, attending the bilateral strategic dialogue with the Biden administration. And you had a meeting yesterday with Secretary of State Anthony Blinken. And I was very struck by the statement that, by the way, that was issued, because it was a very strong statement. It said that in the meeting, the importance of the U.S.-Romania strategic partnership was emphasized. And it went on to praise Romania as a stalwart NATO ally. And you both agreed to collaborate on Black Sea security issues and also Russian aggression against Ukraine. I felt very compelled to state that because it was striking to me the importance of the meeting, the strength of the meeting, and also the outcome of that meeting. Now, you are here in Washington also at a time when the Black Sea region is gaining recognition, and it's become a focal point on this side of the Atlantic, as well as a key area of strategic competition, and notably with Russia, but also with China. So let's begin with this broad question. What are the developments in the region that have been most concerning to you, and how does the strategic environment look from Romania's perspective? How is Romania actively engaging in regional security and development? And welcome again, Minister. Really great to see you.
Well, thank you so much. Good morning or good afternoon, everybody. It's for me a great pleasure to be back to the Atlantic Council, and especially for having this debate. I think it's a very timely moment. And as you mentioned, Ambassador Dobriansky, I'm here for a visit, which is taking place at a very very important moment. This year, we mark the 10th anniversary of the adoption of our joint declaration for the strategic partnership for the 21st century, which is the document, political document, laying the basis for our current strategic partnership, defining the most important dimensions of our strategic partnership. At the same time, there are 10 years since the conclusion of the ballistic missile defense agreement between Romania and the United States, and I'm very proud that I was chief negotiator for both these documents on behalf of Romania 10 years ago. But at the same time, next year, as you mentioned, we are going to celebrate the 25th anniversary of our strategic partnerships in the launching of the strategic partnership during President Clinton's visit to Bucharest in 1997. So, there are a lot of anniversary benchmarks, but these are not just anniversaries. These are, a lot of arguments for being more ambitious and determined for the future, and to develop and deepen our strategic partnership. And that was the essence of our discussions yesterday between myself and my delegation and Secretary Blinken. At the same time, today we have the session of the strategic dialogue between us, which is the body which is implementing the joint declaration of 2011. This is the seventh session of this strategic dialogue, and it is the first with the Biden administration after the last one took place back in 2018. So again, an important moment to see what we can do in all dimensions of our strategic partnership. And indeed, we have focused on security matters, and we have discussed how to improve our coordination within NATO. For instance, in the process of the incoming negotiation of the new strategic concept, we have discussed about the importance of consolidating further the deterrence and defense posture on the whole of the eastern flank in a coherent manner, especially at the Black Sea, where we see that there are a lot of tensions and interesting evolutions, and we are going to talk about this. We have discussed about the importance of increasing the U.S. presence in the region and in Romania. We have discussed about economy, about energy, about the necessity of U.S. involvement in strategic interconnection projects such as Rail to Sea and Via Carpatia, which are very important for the economic recovery and the military mobility in the region. Discussed about nuclear energy cooperation, which is becoming now a true pillar of our strategic partnership, especially after this recently launched bilateral program on small modular reactors, which is a first in the region. And Romania has the very good perspective of becoming a hub of investment and of producing and distributing such kind of innovative technology in the region, thus well diminishing the dependence on various sources of energy from non-like-minded countries. We have discussed a lot of many important issues. But coming back to the Black Sea, indeed, we have been advocating for, I think, more than two decades in Washington about the importance of the Black Sea security as part of the transatlantic security. It is indeed an integral part of the Euro-Atlantic and transatlantic security. And I would say that what happens in the Black Sea does not stay in the Black Sea. It has a lot of impact upon the whole body of transatlantic relations. From the historical point of view, always the region was at the crossroads of various interests, imperial ambitions, clashing ideologies, conflicting trade interests. Of course, it was also a bridge between Asia and Europe. And such, from this perspective, it was a melting pot of different civilizations. And the aspiration for peace and the peaceful coexistence and for cultural exchanges and trade exchanges was always there. But at the same time, we can see that in the last three decades, the Black Sea unfortunately has been a conflict area. And we notice that this trend maintains, unfortunately, in the region. And if we take a look at what happened during this year, for instance, in April, when we have witnessed the Russian massive deployment, probably the biggest deployment of troops since the Cold War era in the region, with a lot of equipment staying there. What we see now, perhaps, or we might see in the region, this is, of course, worrying. And it should concern all of us, not just the riparian countries, not just the littoral countries, but also, I think, NATO as a whole. And the risk of further security challenges, even military security challenges, remains high. And I think we need to take all this into account and to re-energize and reinforce our efforts to build security and stability and, of course, prosperity in the Black Sea region.
Thank you. You really gave us a very detailed overview of your meeting with the Secretary of State and then also about your core interests and what's happening in the region. You mentioned Russia and Russia's investment, but let me ask you about China. In fact, it was just this summer that Romania banned Huawei from its 5G networks. And to what extent are you concerned about China's growing investment and involvement in the Black Sea region? How will Romania continue to approach both competition and cooperation with China?
Well, I wouldn't say that we have banned a certain company or a certain country. We have implemented a very modern 5G normative framework in Romania. It is a normative framework which was signed off by President Iohannis in June, and it takes into account our national interests, our commitments, and of course our commitments related to our allies and partners like the United States. Romania was the first country in the world to sign a memorandum of understanding on 5G security with the United States back in 2019. And this new legislation, which was adopted by the Romanian parliament, embodies those commitments included in the memorandum of understanding, but also the EU regulations on that matter. For instance, the EU toolbox on 5G is included in that piece of legislation. And of course, we have to remain responsible as far as the security of our communications and cyber environment. And such kind of legislation is basically a response to this concerns and commitments. So the new legislation is not targeting any particular country, but it will ensure that any company complying with the conditions and completing a national security screening will be able to operate on the Romanian market. It is as simple as that. At the same time, when we see certain malicious cyber activities directed against democratic countries managed from the Chinese national territory, we react. And we have joined, for instance, this July, the United States, the European Union, the UK, and NATO and other partners in expressing concern for such malicious cyber activities. At our national level, we have a principled but at the same time pragmatic approach towards China. And what we would like to see is a mutual respect for our legitimate interests in terms of economy, but also in terms of security. We are taking into account the membership of Romania into NATO and the European Union and the values that are embodied in these two essential organizations for Romania's foreign and security policy, and we are acting as such. For the rest, of course, we are looking forward to an engagement with China, of course, in accordance with these parameters.
Well, as I've indicated, the Black Sea is certainly a battleground in a way, of course, in great power competition, but not just from a security and military standpoint. How is Romania actually working to strengthen democratic principles in the region? Part of this is the moral narrative. You know, how can we better compete in this information environment? And what can we be doing better to strengthen democracy in the region and win this battle of ideas and of narratives?
Well, it's not easy, of course, because we are not, trained to respond to such a type of aggression, which is a type of hybrid, assertive behavior towards our democracy, rule of law, set of fundamental rights, among which, of course, the freedom of expression. And what we should do, and I think Romania is doing that already, is to support independent journalism, to support independent media, and to see what kind of measures may be taken in order to reinforce this freedom. And for instance, I will give you a couple of examples. Last year, through the funds which are managed by the Ministry of Foreign Affairs within the Cooperation for International Development and Humanitarian Assistance, we have provided through the European Endowment for Democracy, €100,000, for instance, for supporting the independent media and civil society in Belarus. We have done the same for the Republic of Moldova. Last year, €250,000, and this year, €300,000 for that. These are very concrete examples efforts to support independent media in the countries around us, where this is badly needed. But it is also needed within our own countries. And I think it is very important that we train the general public to be very careful when they well, read pieces of information and to pay particular attention to sources and, if possible, to the hidden agenda of certain messages which are trying to undermine the trust in, well, democratic values in the organizations we are part of. Well, for instance, when you see Sputnik saying that, well, Romania and the EU are doing well, such and such things. Well, in fact, Romania is EU. Romania is NATO. We are not, an entity outside this organization. But that kind of message is trying to assert or to induce or to suggest that we are still away from those organizations, which is not true. But this is undermining the trust of the public and the feeling of belonging to those sets of values embodied in those organizations. So we need to mobilize all public institutions to work in that direction. We need to have a public communication which is coordinated, an approach which is coordinated. We need coherent national and common EU-NATO narratives on certain important topics. Such as those related to the, for instance, security in the region, or the cybersecurity issues. So that's why we are trying to use existing tools, new tools. We have created this year in Bucharest a Euro-Atlantic Center for Resilience, and we are working on that institution. We want to make it international. We are working now on building the capacity of this institution and looking forward to make it fully operational. And we would like to see experts from NATO member states, from EU member states, from our partners joining the center and working together to gather good practices, lessons learned, and then spreading this good practices and lessons learned and training and using the best practices in order to cope with such kind of challenges. And last but not least, I want to mention the fact that, well, perhaps the best way to counter disinformation is the what we actually do in real terms on the ground. Mm-hmm. And I'll give you the example of the EU. What better way to increase trust and confidence in EU institutions is but to see how the EU responded to the pandemic crisis. Mm-hmm. By building a joint acquisition mechanism for medicines and for vaccines, without which we were very much unable to counter the pandemic in an efficient manner, or to see that the EU is allotting recovery funds, for instance, in the case of Romania, almost 30 billion euros for recovery projects. Well, such kinds of actions are the best response to hybrid activities of the kind that you have mentioned.
By the way, Minister, I'm going to go to a couple of questions that have come from our viewers, and I want to thank Anka, because actually her question was in fact about the center, but you answered it, I believe, in terms of its purpose, Anka Agachi. But let me add a piece of what she said here, because it's interesting. She said, you know, that as Russian aggression and interference expands in the Black Sea region, including in non-traditional domains, resilience will increase in importance. And you referenced that. Romania has made good strides in this regard, including by opening a Euro-Atlantic Center for Resilience. But it's interesting, the question she has is, how do you see Romania's role in this area, and what more can NATO and the transatlantic community do when it comes to resilience? How do you see NATO connected into this piece? And I have one more question I want to weave in just on the Black Sea from another viewer. But if you would take this one.
Well, NATO is concerned with the concept of resilience for quite some time, even before the crisis. There were already seven principles regarding resilience, which were agreed upon within NATO, regarding various aspects of the resilience, which are of concern for NATO. For instance, resilience of transport routes, resilience in case of massive crisis, or in case of a large number of casualties, and so on. NATO was concerned with resilience even before the pandemic. The pandemic has prompted a new debate on the resilience, taking into account the need to respond to certain challenges which were prompted by the pandemic. The most important ones were, within the EU range of action. They were related to what I have already mentioned, the capacity to respond to the crisis, the capacity to acquire medicines and medical equipment. We all remember that at the beginning of the pandemic last year, it was a shortage in masks, in other critical equipments. And we were forced to acquire them from countries outside the transatlantic or Euro-Atlantic community, and some of these countries like China tried to use this advantage. So one of the important lessons learned after the pandemic unfolded was that we need to create our own production. Create our own sources of and lines of supply, and to get rid of a certain high degree of dependence from partners which are not like-minded mm-hmm. with us. This goes as well for other critical areas, and this prompted in the EU, for instance, the creation of the Union for Health. The process of improving certain mechanisms that we have used during the pandemic, for instance, the civil protection mechanism within the European Union. So this center we have created in Bucharest is a result of a reflection process that I have started already last year during the pandemic, how to make Romania more resilient as far as foreign policy is concerned, and to combine the process of reflection on resilience within NATO and that from within the European Union. And the center is now, as I mentioned, in the process of being built up. And we have in mind the creation of 7 working groups or community of interest, as we call them, issues related to resilience, societal resilience, for instance. Resilience in the field of emerging and disruptive technologies, resilience of communication and technological ecosystems, resilience to complex crises and emergencies, ensuring the continuity of government and essential services, resilience of the transport infrastructure, mm-hmm. And of course we want to support our partners to become more resilient in the face of non-state actors and state actors' malign influence on countries which are our partners, both EU and NATO partners.
All right. Well, thank you. Thank you for that. And also thank you, Anka, for that question. I want to raise another question, and I'm going to also integrate my own into it, from Robert Lupitu, who says, what would the minister say are the main lines of pillars that Romania considers to be paramount for a future U.S. strategy for the Black Sea? Let me just add to that. You, Fred mentioned in his opening, you know that the U.S. Secretary of Defense Lloyd Austin just visited the Black Sea mm-hmm. region last month, including Romania. And, you know, what more activity or present would you like to see from the United States? So let me pair both of these questions together.
Well, we have discussed yesterday between our two delegations. I've discussed this with Secretary Blinken, and I have expressed willingness and openness of Romania to take part in the process of drafting of the Black Sea strategy mm-hmm. of the United States. And I've already forwarded some preliminary ideas. And what we think it's important is to have a multifaceted approach to the security in the Black Sea. It's not just about the classic security and about the classic military means. I think it's important, of course, to increase, and this is part of the response to your part of the question. Basically, I think the U.S. Military presence in the region, both in terms of troops and equipment, should be increased. Not just in Romania, but I think in the southern part of the eastern flank, because, as you mentioned, there is a tailored forward presence in the southern part of the eastern flank and an enhanced forward presence in the northern part of the eastern flank. So we need to have more cohesion as far as the eastern flank as a whole is concerned. There is a sort of disbalance at the moment between the resources allotted to the northern part and the resources allotted to the southern part. So we need to balance it and to have more resources in the southern part of the eastern flank and to continue to build this coherent approach of the eastern flank as a whole. The negotiations on the new strategic concept of NATO will bring a good opportunity for that, but also we have to do it anyway because this is part of the NATO 2030 process. We have started within NATO last year in December. And beyond this approach to classic security, I think there is a need, for instance, to tackle the protracted conflicts in the region. We have neglected. We have become, somehow accustomed to these protracted conflicts. We know that they exist there, but they are there, and from time to time they are not. Some call them frozen, but they are not frozen. What is frozen is the solution of these conflicts. The conflicts are there. Their resolution is being delayed, and I think we have to move forward with that. I have taken the initiative together with other 10 foreign ministers of the European Union to include this topic on the agenda of the Foreign Affairs Council of the European Union. And we had a strategic discussion on how EU can be more influential on protracted conflicts in May in Lisbon. And then together with colleagues from Austria and Lithuania, I've paid a visit to the southern Caucasus countries in June. And we have come back with a set of proposals, which we have presented to the Foreign Affairs Council. We will continue to be involved in that area. Beyond protracted conflicts, I think it's important to take a look at the energy security dimension of the region. And we have witnessed the gas crisis in Moldova, which was very worrying. I think it's a sort of a case study of action against a country in the region. And I think countries in the region should be reinforced in the face of such kind of challenges. Beyond that, I think economy is another area where we should be more active. Need to help these countries in the Black Sea region to cope with the challenges, economic challenges prompted by the pandemic. We need to be very much involved in supporting the democratic processes, reinforcing the rule of law, democratic values, the fundamental rights in these countries. I think this is something that we can work together and might be a part of the outcomes of the Summit for Democracy that President Biden is organizing at the end of this year.
Minister, I wanted to be specific. You mentioned frozen conflict. So when you were describing the steps that Romania is taking, you are taking these steps with regard to Georgia and Ukraine because you use the term frozen conflicts. Is that the specific kind of support that you're giving to help partners and specifically Georgia and Ukraine?
Well, when I'm mentioning protracted conflicts, it's not just about Georgia and Ukraine, because if you take a look at the six countries in the Eastern Partnership, five of them have protracted conflicts on their territories.
But you also said also frozen conflicts, so that's why.
Yes, because some of the analysts use alternatively the term frozen, protracted. But frozen is misleading because sometimes these conflicts become very warm, as we can see in Nagorno-Karabakh last year, or we can see each and every time in Donbas. They are protracted. The resolution of this conflict is frozen, in fact, and perhaps protracted. So we have to take care of this conflict if we want to have a better security climate in the Black Sea region. Speaking of Georgia and Ukraine, we should also use the regional formats that we have created, and they are available to us. For instance, in April, when it was a peak of deployment of Russian equipment and troops in the Black Sea region in and around Ukraine, I have organized in Bucharest a meeting of the trilateral on security issues between Romania, Poland, and Turkey. And on that occasion, for the first time, we have invited Georgia and Ukraine to join us. And it was a very powerful signal that we have sent, discussing with these countries and providing support and encouragement to these countries during the very peak of that regional tension. We have to use the B9, the Bucharest 9 format. The Bucharest 9 format is very useful because it includes all allies, the nine allies on the eastern flank, and it allows us to coordinate before NATO summits and to increase our coordination within within NATO. And I'm very glad that the summit organized by President Johannes in May, the B9 summit, was attended by President Biden, was attended by the NATO Secretary General. And the message sent on that occasion by President Biden was very powerful. President Biden said that, the transatlantic partnership doesn't include only the two shores of the Atlantic, but goes beyond and across the Europe up to the Black Sea region. So there is a strong commitment expressed on that occasion by President Biden for the security of the allies on the eastern flank. And that message was repeated during the NATO summit in June. And President Biden made a reference, an explicit reference to the B9 format, which was, very interesting. There is another format that I think you are very familiar with. It's the Three Seas Initiative.
Yes.
And that is about the economic, volet of our efforts. And we can use the Three Seas Initiative to build economic development in the region. It is also very useful as a tool to, reinforce cohesion within the European Union, because it helps us cope with the gap in development between the countries in this region and the EU countries of the western part of the region. Mm-hmm. And last but not least, it's a very good instrument for positive transatlantic cooperation.
Minister, we only have about 8 more minutes, and I want to try to get in 2 questions. And I'm going to take one question from our audience and then also have a concluding one relative to what you just said, the Three Seas Initiative. I have to take the question, of course, from the former Bulgarian ambassador to the United States, Elena Poptodorova. She asked the question, how is Romania approaching regional cooperation among the three NATO littoral states in the Black Sea with Bulgaria and Turkey? Is it possible to develop this cooperation further in the context of NATO's new strategic concept? And if you'll respond to that, and then I do want to squeeze in one more question. So if you'd please answer that, but let's try to get one more question in before we have to wrap. And I'm going to combine mine with Aura Sabatis's question, which does relate to energy and markets. Mm-hmm. But on Ambassador Poptodorova's question.
Our cooperation with both Bulgaria and Turkey is very good, and we have a permanent process of consultations with our Bulgarian friends, and we share the same goal of having more security in the Black Sea. And I think during the process of negotiation of the new strategic concept, we will interact a lot in terms of protecting this common goal to have more security in the Black Sea and more NATO in the Black Sea. With Turkey, Romania has a strategic partnership. This year we have celebrated the 10th anniversary of that strategic partnership with Turkey. Turkey is also one of our biggest trade partners. It's the, I think, the number 4 or number 5 among all trade partners of Romania and the first outside the EU. So we have a lot of joint interests with Turkey, and I've just mentioned the trilateral format with Poland and Turkey, which is very helpful in discussing security matters in an informal manner, but yet at the level of foreign ministers. Security matters related to the Black Sea region, but also related to other areas of interest for the three countries, including protracted conflicts. So interaction with Turkey in the context of NATO is perhaps sometimes challenging because we don't have the same approach towards NATO involvement. But at the end of the day, the goal is the same, having more security in the Black Sea area. And I'm very confident that during the negotiation of the strategic concept, we will be able at the end of the whole process to have good solutions for the security in the Black Sea region.
All right, well, thank you for that. Let me ask my final question. I'm going to combine mine with Aura Sabatis. No, we want to get in as many as we can with you. We are benefiting from your presence here. Ora says, turning to economic development in the region, what measures is Romania taking to integrate energy markets further with Moldova and Ukraine? If you'd respond to that, and at the same time, what I'd like to ask, because you mentioned the Three Seas Initiative, which is something that the Atlantic Council certainly is very supportive of. What are Romania's priorities for the initiative? And what do you see as the strategic implications for greater infrastructure development? I think that's where my question combines and reinforces Aura's.
Well, we are working with both Moldova and Ukraine, including on energy aspects. I think recently we had a round of consultations on energy security matters with Ukraine, if I'm not mistaken, or at least it was well scheduled to be organized. Then with Moldova, we have interacted a lot during the recent gas crisis. And as you know, we have built a gas interconnector between Romania and the Republic of Moldova. And this pipeline is functional. And we have supplied 1.5 million cubic meters during the gas crisis in the Republic of Moldova. We have provided a lot of support in many other ways. We have contemplated, for instance, the delivery of tar in order for Moldova to produce electricity. We have advocated a lot regarding Moldova's interests during this crisis at the EU level. Myself at the Foreign Affairs Council on the 18th of October, President Iohannis during the European Council in the same week. I have discussed with the NATO Secretary General on the same issue. I have discussed with the EU ambassadors in Bucharest on this. So we are doing our best to help the Republic of Moldova to be less dependent on external gas and other energy sources. And we will continue to build our electricity connections with the Republic of Moldova. This is on our joint agenda, and we will continue with that. On the Three Seas Initiative, the most important projects that are there in the Three Seas Initiative for Romania are Rail to Sea and Via Carpatia. Rail to Sea is a railway connecting the Romanian port of Constanța, the Black Sea, with the Polish port of Gdansk in Poland. And it's a very important connection because we don't have currently in the Three Seas Initiative region a good connection between the north and the south of this region, and we need that connection. Such a railway could be the link which is now missing, and allowing us on one hand to stimulate economic development, to stimulate economic recovery after the pandemic, but also to be very instrumental in terms of facilitating the military mobility on the eastern flank. And we are discussing this matter with the U.S. administration because we want a visible U.S. involvement, including financial, in this project, and as well as far as Via Carpatia is concerned. I think it's very important that U.S. is present in the region not only with an enhanced military participation, but also with an economic footprint, in order to consolidate the U.S. presence in the region and the confidence of the countries in the region in the transatlantic partnership.
Minister, thank you so much, first of all, for coming in person today. We're really so delighted to welcome you here at the Atlantic Council. And congratulations also on what seems to have been an outstanding dialogue and meeting that you've had with the Secretary of State and the State Department. But also, we very much appreciate the very detailed and comprehensive questions detailed and comprehensive answers that you've given to our questions. And I also want to thank our viewers very much for their active participation. Thank you, and really just we'll look forward to the next time. Minister, thanks again.
Well, thank you so much for this opportunity. It was a pleasure to be here.
Thank you.